We were stupid. Basically, we didn't know any better. We just followed the doctor. And in college, it's easy too. For lunch, I'll have like a salad and a double cheeseburger, no bun. And I'm in like the best shape of my life, physically and mentally. So my whole motivation is to show people, you know, this is possible, not following the typical ADA, 40 carb per meal, low protein, high carb. Right now, I feel incredible based on what I'm doing. I can lift heavy. I can do anything basically athletically. I felt that way during high school as well. My health, I feel like, is so important to me. It doesn't really make sense for me to ever just like deviate just for a piece of birthday cake. And what I've been able to do at home is, you know, make low carb versions of all those foods anyway. So it's not like I'm really missing anything.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. We have, well, forgive me, but we have, you're on Dave's account. So what is your first name, David, as well?
Yes.
First okay. Name is David. Well, that makes sense. I interviewed your dad a while ago. It's good to have you, man. Yeah. So awesome having you here. And I've actually heard quite a bit about your story already, but I'll let you get started. Tell us a little bit about yourself. Where are you? You're out in Waco, Texas, right? Over at Baylor.
I'm in Waco, Texas. Yeah. I'm a student at Baylor right now.
Okay. Nice. Nice.
Yeah. Been a type 1 diabetic for about 11 years. I think it just may have been my 12th or 11 year anniversary a couple days ago.
Okay.
So yeah, nice to celebrate that. Parents just came back from Hawaii because my brother had a water polo tournament. So it was nice to see them celebrate that milestone.
So you were diagnosed at what, 11 years of age or 12 years of age?
Third grade.
Okay. So that's gotta be, I mean, I don't know if you remember it. I mean, that's gotta be kind of a weird thing. What were you told back then? What did you think as a 10-year-old kid, 9-year-old kid?
It was a weird place to be in. In my third grade, you could see pictures from, I guess, throughout the year where I could see that my face was visibly sunken in, dark circles around my eyes. Mm-hmm. I remember I had lost a lot of weight at that point. In class, you know, teachers reported to my parents that I'd have my head down on the table at all times. My flag football team, poor performance in that. I didn't really feel like how a kid should feel, and I didn't know what was the cause of that. And neither did my parents at that point. I was all aware of type 1 or type 2 diabetes, basically because, you know, family members of friends could hear about it that way, but none of us were ever aware of type 1. And it was in the month of March. That whole month, I just remember not being able to walk, always having to, you know, go and pee probably like once or twice an hour, all basic symptoms of type 1 diabetes. It even got to the point where I remember my dad had to take my shirt off and I looked like a skeleton, and that freaked everybody out almost to the point of like tears. And seeing my parents like that, exhausted, frightened, scared, really kind of clicked in my head, like, holy moly, something is definitely wrong. So then we had to go to the doctors. And the crazy story about this is it was like a replacement doctor. So it wasn't a real doctor. And what she thought was just stomach flu, like basic stomach flu, needed to get more calories into me, needed to get more, I guess, sugar carbs into me. So the literal prescription for what she thought I had was to go and drink a milkshake. Mm-hmm. And at that point, my blood sugars, because I would be in at DKA in that point. So my blood sugars would probably be around like the 400 level, like close to death, basically. So we got milkshakes because we didn't know any better. We were just stupid. Basically, we didn't know any better. We just followed the doctor. That, I guess, pushed it over the edge. I was right at the cliff, and that basically pushed it over the edge. So got sent to the ER room a couple of days later because our real doctor called and said I'd had type 1 diabetes. So got rushed to the ER room. That was a freaky experience. Got basically pushed. I was on a gurney, basically, and got pushed through the double doors. No idea what's going on. Bunch of doctors around me taking blood. My first real experience in a hospital, too. And those following days, I guess, kind of explained what the disease was and put me through the ringer of what, you know, normal kid would be put through in my position.
Yeah, that's got to be kind of terrifying, you know. And for those who don't know, I mean, the urination, the polyuria, because the blood glucose is so high, your body's just trying to pee it all off to try to get that blood glucose down. And, you know, obviously, 120 years ago, this would be a death sentence for the most part. I mean, kids wouldn't survive that. They would just waste away to nothing. No matter how much they ate, they couldn't, you know, that shows you the value of insulin. A lot of people in the low carb community demonize insulin, but it's absolutely necessary for life and extremely important for us to hang on to vital structures, tissues, whether it's body fat or muscle or any kind of tissue at all. type 1 diabetes is still kind of a mystery in the regards that we don't know really what causes it. Some people think maybe there's a viral or viral antecedent or something. Anything you can was there any, I mean, you may have been too young to even remember. Were you like sick before or anything like that?
As far as I know, I don't have any history of type 1 diabetes in my family, on my mom or brother or father's side. And what I was told in the doctor is basically just, they didn't tell me any like possible cause for it. They just told me, you know, pancreas stopped working, shutting down, not able to maintain, you know, insulin levels or inject glucose into my bloodstream anymore. So all those are out of whack. And they said basically like 1 out of 10,000 is what I remember being told, disease, and no, I guess, exact cause for it or something that I would have, you know, done in the past that would have increased my chances for it or anything like that.
Yeah. And so, I mean, obviously they made a mistake in misdiagnosing you, which is already right. Kind of strike one. And so what are they, so now you're diagnosed, you got a correct diagnosis, your blood glucose is, you know, whatever, super high, maybe you're in DKA, which is, you know, can be life-threatening. Right. What do they tell you from that? What is the next thing they tell you to do? Where's your
life? So at that point, they get my blood sugars down. First of all, was their main priority. You know, I'm on IV because I'm severely lacking nutrients, I guess. And then we have my endocrinologist come in, I guess, on the first night before bed. And he kind of explains the, I guess, very keynotes version of what diabetes is, because it's a lot to process, I guess, as a 10-year-old kid and as parents who don't really understand it either. So he shows me, grabs the orange, does the injecting insulin kind of thing. And then I guess the thing that really stuck with me most was what they tell you from a dietary standpoint on what you're supposed to do and what they want you to do. And that's the standard ADA diet, you know, 40 carbs per meal. They show you a picture of what you are supposed to eat, which is like they go, okay, for breakfast tomorrow, you're going to have a banana, you're going to have eggs, you're going to have pancakes, and you're going to have milk. Mm-hmm. And then he talks to me about what your blood sugars do in reaction to that. And he'll say, okay, so they're going to go up to about 200 and they're going to go down. And he told me that was a result of the carbs in the food that I was eating. Carbs, sugar, all, you know, convert into glucose, which will raise your blood sugar. And even as a kid, I was kind of like, why would I even eat pancakes if, you know, normal blood sugars are supposed to be between 80 and 100 and they'll never kind of vary from that. Why is it healthy for me to be in the 200s and then have to come crashing down from eating pancakes? Why would I just not eat carbs? And that's kind of been what I've continuously been confused about as far as, what doctors are saying for type 1 diabetics to eat. I've always been confused about like why there's no, you know, real need. I'm basically in, you know, eating what I'm eating. In college, it's easy too. For lunch, I'll have like a salad and a double cheeseburger, no bun. And I'm in like the best shape of my life physically and mentally. So I've always just kind of been confused about that. And that's kind of been my whole motivation is to kind of show people, you know, this is possible, not following the typical ADA 40 carb per meal, low protein, high carb, what they would recommend.
Yeah. Yeah. And so it's, sounds like your Dexcom's going off there.
Yeah.
I can hear it. So
I think that's just like an alarm for, time. Yeah. Sorry.
Okay.
About that.
Okay. Well, that's no problem. So, you know, this is, something that's obviously the, you know, the big elephant in the room is why are we feeding type 1 and type 2 diabetics so many carbohydrates and just telling them, you know, particularly the type 1s to chase it with insulin, because as you know, it's almost impossible to do accurately. You overshoot, you undershoot, you overcorrect, right. You know, your hypos, your, you know, then you're trading off hyperglycemia to hypos and you rarely have any time where you're feeling kind of normal. You know, what was your diet prior to, do you remember your diet prior to becoming diabetic? I mean, you know, if you tell a kid, hey, you eat pancakes and a banana and some, you know, something like that. Most kids are, okay, that's cool. That's good. I'm already eating that anyway.
No, I guess that's how I would describe my diet is basically just like take an average American kid and ask them their diet, a non-obese American kid, and then ask them their diet. And that would probably be it. I'd do like oatmeal in the morning. Dinner would probably be like a sandwich of some sorts. I wouldn't say my diet was necessarily unhealthy. I would say unhealthy from my standards today, but it wasn't, I guess, an unhealthy diet in general. It was just kind of normal, I would say. Nothing too out of the ordinary.
Okay, so you get this advice, you know, 40 grams of carbs at meals, you know, eat pancakes for breakfast and, you know, whatever. Did you attempt to do that for a period of time? How did that go?
Yeah, we attempted to do that for probably, I would say, the first 2 months where, you know, obviously you talk to my dad, he's a big science guy, big numbers guy. So our whole problem solving would be like, okay, so we're going to eat the oatmeal because that's what we're told to do. And then we're going to try to bolus 15 minutes earlier and see how that works. And we're going to try to do more insulin here and then maybe do a second shot half an hour in to try to keep that stable. And so we kept, I guess, tinkering with that for the first 2 months until, you know, we kind of just sat down and we're like, this isn't working. This, like, it's too unpredictable. The amount of carbs with the amount of insulin I'm taking, it's just way too unpredictable, because then you start to factor in things like, am I being active that day? Am I just sitting down and doing nothing? Do I have like something that would boost my adrenaline levels, which would cause, so there's just way too much variation with that. And whenever you're dealing with high numbers of carbs, high numbers of insulin, it's incredibly difficult to nail down something that would keep you level, nearly impossible. So after that kind of 2 month experience that we had, our experiment that we had with various foods, high carb foods that, you know, were basically in like the ADA meal plan, we at that point had enough. So we lasted for about 2 months trying to work that out.
Okay. And I mean, did they give you like a ADA approved dietitian or a diabetic nurse educator or something like that? And did you like contact these people and say, hey, this is challenging, I'm it's not working or anything like that?
So I think we had a dietitian come talk to us in the hospital. And after that, we basically had no communication after that. We kind of talked to our endocrinologist, who would basically relay the same things that I'm assuming that the dietitian would say regarding to food, carbs, insulin. But no, we never really were in constant contact with the dietitian.
So how did you, I know because your dad was intimately involved in this stuff, but I mean, how did you guys figure out, okay, well, if this isn't working, what are we going to try next?
What my parents did was furiously research this topic, basically trying to know like literally everything about type 1 diabetes and managing as there is to know. And they stumbled upon the book, Dr. Bernstein's Diabetes Solution, which I guess pretty much changed the trajectory of my life as far as giving a plan that makes sense. And once we tried that for about the first week, I don't have the graphs on me, but there's pictures of my graphs from the first week as opposed to the first 2 months. And it's stark contrast of what they were. My standard deviation was down tremendously. I wasn't going to, you know, the 250s, 300s at all. I wasn't having any severe hypoglycemias. I was needing less insulin to bolus for foods, and it was working a lot better. So I guess around the 2 month mark, we ordered that book, read it, all made sense to us. And that's where I am today, is just, you know, kind of refining that method.
So how did you change your diet? So what does the diet look like then and now?
Basically, we went like all in as a family. And I think that's, again, one of the most important things for a young type 1 diabetic kid that is trying to do this, is just, I think you need the family support and just to go all in as a family. And what that meant for us was we got rid of like all the cereals in our houses, all the, you know, oatmeal stuff. We basically went on a low carb, high protein diet. While, you know, we still had, I guess, in the first couple of weeks, I can't think of any examples of what we had, but I know it wasn't as, I guess, refined as it is 10 years later, but it was basically protein, vegetables, nuts, some fruit. We haven't really changed that too much, and I haven't had any issues with it.
What were your, you know, because you're starting out as a third grader, you know, 9-10 year old kid, and then you go on. What were your, after you kind of switched over to a diet that works better for you, what were your, you know, blood sugars and hemoglobin, what's your hemoglobin A1C like? Because typically kids tend to have the worst A1Cs of any type 1 diabetic, just because kids are impulsive and they can't keep track of things, and they end up with, you know, A1Cs 8-9 pretty typically. Where were you at?
I remember, I guess, when I was first diagnosed, I would probably assume I was in the 7s or 8s. And then once kind of we hit that switch, read the book, I think my first A1C was like a 6.4 or something. And then it only gradually decreased to now where I'm in the, I've been in like the high 4s, low 5s for about, you know, 10 years now, but it never, ever got back up. I had, I guess, supreme trust in my parents and what they were doing. And I could like visibly see the results on my CGM.
Yeah.
So I never argued, had a problem with it. I like to think I stayed extremely disciplined. And I think the fact that my parents were so all in, and I had such a good relationship with them kind of allowed me to just go in with them with this.
And how long have you had a CGMs? I don't know if they were out quite when you were first diagnosed or not widely distributed, but I mean, how long have you had the CGM?
Probably about 10 years. I think it was more uncommon than it is today, but it was still out there. So we got on that.
Got it. So that really helps you to dial in a lot better. You can kind of see.
Right. It makes it a lot easier.
In somewhat real time, there's about a 15 minute delay, but Mm-hmm. Very good for correcting that. Insulin, how does that work for you now these days? I mean, obviously, some people are on a pump. Some people are on different routine. You know, some people have automatic infusions, basal bolus. What does your regimen look like?
So what I use is Novalin and Novolog. It's a fast-acting insulin and a slow-acting insulin. Mm-hmm. And then I use Triceba, which is a Levemir, which I'll do when I wake up every morning. And it lasts the entire day until, mm-hmm. you know, the next morning, which I'll do it again. And what I use R, which is the slow acting for my meals. Mm-hmm. And that's to, I guess, match protein, cause I eat high protein, low carb. So what I do is I try to match the protein curve. So protein will act very slowly, rise very slowly. It won't be like, if I eat like a muffin, for example, I'll go straight up. And so the R kind of matches that curve and follows along with it. So I don't ever see any big rises. So yeah, protein foods react to blood sugars very slowly. Even if you're mismatching, it still counteracts the curve. What the R does for me is it prevents protein from turning into glucose. So that'll keep me stable. And then if I ever do happen to go, you know, above 110, 115, I have the fast acting R, which I'll do in my deltoid or my thigh, which will act much faster. So I'll do like a unit and a half at most of that, and then just kind of go down a little bit faster. But the thing is, with the amount of insulin that I'm doing, being only like a unit or a unit and a half, I'm never crashing down where I'm needing like tons of glucose, or I pretty much never have hypoglycemias.
Yeah. And that's one of the things, you know, a lot of the endocrinologists, that's one of the reasons they tell people to get carbs all the time, because they're terrified about hypoglycemic episodes, because, you know, you could potentially have a seizure or a coma, or there's all kinds of negative things that go on with hypoglycemia for sure. Do you find, you know, does the size of the protein meal with your blood glucose, there's some studies out there suggest like over like 75 grams of protein in one setting can stimulate glycogen breakdown in the liver under the power of glucagon. You know, there's kind of a threshold there. If you'd like a little tiny, I don't know, 20 gram protein snack, do you dose that differently than if you dose like a big meal, like you eat a pound of steak or something like that?
Right. So the amount of protein the amount of R I take will depend on, I guess, the amount of food I eat. So if I, you know, go out for my birthday to like a steakhouse and eat like a big 24 ounce, like ribeye, mm-hmm. I'll know that I'll need a lot more insulin, and probably even, so I'll take, for example, 10 units of R for that. And I do it in my butt, the most fatty part of my body, I guess. So it works way slower because the steak will be a very slow, gradual rise. Mm-hmm. And then I'll make sure that I need to, you know, wake up at like 3 a.m. in the morning to make sure I'm not rising up, because it does, since it's a lot of protein, it does continue to keep going up. So, you know, maybe I'll need like a unit in the middle of the night, maybe a unit and a half at most. But if I'm eating like a 20 gram bag of like Quest protein chips, I'll do probably like 2 or 3 units of R, mm-hmm. but definitely not nearly as much as like a steak or a burger or something like that.
Yeah. And the correction you do in the middle of the night, is that the rapid acting, the Novalin?
Yeah, that'll be the rapid.
Okay. Yeah. Just for a correction type of thing. I know you were into sports as a kid. I mean, did you have any trouble putting on muscle and training and playing sports while eating, I guess, relatively low carb the whole time?
No, I had no problem. I was, I guess in peak physical form for what I could have been at that time, how young I was, high school student. I never had trouble with that. I guess the only trouble with sports, I would say, that took a while to kind of manage was the adrenaline kick, which mm-hmm. would cause my blood sugars to spike. So if I go in a basketball game, or if I'm taking a snap as a quarterback, obviously everybody's heart, you know, goes crazy during that. You're very nervous and all that. So your adrenaline will cause your blood sugar to spike. And that was tough to manage, because you don't want to necessarily deltoid that, because you don't really have any food backing that rise. So what will happen is you'll crash if that happens. So you kind of almost want to mitigate that rise by preparation, what you do before. So what I would do is have a meal that I know for a fact I could bolus for, take an amount of insulin that I'll know I'll stay 80 to 90 without any rise. I guess I would say probably more fat in that meal, so I could just have enough energy for the game. I'd be level, wouldn't have to worry about that. And it'd be smooth sailing for the game. It's when you introduce, I guess, variables or things that you haven't tried or start experimenting before those big games or anything like that, or sports activity, is when you kind of run into problems. So I've figured that in. And as far as like a workout muscle building standpoint, like I said earlier, I'm in the best physical shape of my life right now. I feel incredible based on what I'm doing. I can lift heavy. I can do anything basically athletically. I felt that way during high school as well.
Yeah, good for you. So I'm just curious about when you eat a little fattier meal, because you tend to, you know, you said you eat a lot of high protein, low carb, but the fat is kind of variable. When you add fat in there, how does that change your insulin strategy? Does that mean you have to, because a lot of times fat will delay the rise even farther. You know, you'll have an even right. even more slower rise. So how do you do that? Does that mean multiple dosings throughout the day, or how do you deal with a fattier meal?
So the beautiful thing about what I'm doing and what a lot of people are doing on this kind of more low carb focused meals is that you're eating in such, I guess I'm trying to think of a way to phrase this. So you're not eating a lot of things that will convert into high or turn into high blood sugars at all anyway. So the extra fat will be like a heavy cream protein smoothie after I exercise, just so I prevent lows after exercise. So that will be different because it won't be different because I'll just kind of bolus the same and see how I do. If I ever get anything wrong, the worst that will happen is I'll go up to like 105, 110 because of how low carb, low sugar, the things are what I'm eating. And when I usually tend to eat high fat foods is after exercise. So at that point I'll tend to go on the lower side. If I didn't eat anything after like a, you know, 3-hour football game, I'll be like, okay, you know, use a lot of energy, exerted a lot of energy. I'll probably start going low if I don't have like a recovery meal, a recovery shake. So that'll kind of negate that. And that will cause that being exerting that much energy and stuff will make it so I won't have to, you know, bolus again in 4 hours. If I had like my recovery shake when I was just sitting down and like on my computer all day, I would have to, you know, bolus more and probably bolus again in like 4 hours to mitigate that rise.
How do you deal with, you know, sleep, you know, bedtime? Because, you know, obviously when you're asleep, you can't really track this as well. Sometimes alarms will wake you up and things like that. But I mean, is there a strategy like I'm going to go to bed and I had a big meal and I need to extra bolus before I go to bed to keep that down? How do you deal with that?
So I would say that the most important thing is preparation. As like a college student, when I was back home, my dad helped me out a lot at night. And it's still nice because we're 4 hours ahead in Texas. So if I'm, you know, if he ever needs to remind me, he'll just text me and then I'll wake up from that because he's 4 hours behind. So he can still kind of watch me during the night. But I would say preparation. I try not to eat a lot of my foods past 8 or 9. I try to have dinner around 6 or 7 because if I do eat a big dinner at 9 or 10, I don't want to have to, you know, wake up 3 or 4 times a night to make sure I'm not, you know, rising or dropping or anything like that. So I try to go to bed at like a stable 80, stable 90, just so I know that I have, you know, very low variables of what my number can do. I pretty much know at that point it's okay. I'm good for the next 7 hours while I sleep. So I don't really, you know, I wake up anyway. Everybody wakes up to go, you know, drink water, et cetera. And then I'll just check my number and make sure everything's good. And usually it'll be 80 or 90. Mm-hmm. So the main thing I would say is preparation. And I would try to avoid big meals past like 8.
Okay. Just kind of it's kind of interesting that the fact that you have type 1 diabetes almost forces you to be healthy. I mean, if you want to deal with this, and there's a lot of data showing maybe not eating late meals is better for us, you know, compared, you know, overall. And there's obviously not eating these super high glycemic foods that cause so many people to have problems with that. I mean, how difficult was it, you know, at school, peer pressure, you know, hey, why don't you eat dessert? I imagine at some point you've said, hey, I'm gonna have a piece of cake or something like that in the last 10 years, or have you been not able to do
that? I've never been really put in that situation as far as, like I felt like I needed to have a piece of birthday cake or any peer pressure situation like that. I like to, you know, pride myself in never or being disciplined enough to never, allow myself to kind of go off the rails like that. Because it's my health, I feel like is so important to me that I would just, it doesn't really make sense for me to ever just like deviate just for a piece of birthday cake. And what I've been able to do at home is, you know, make low carb versions of all those foods anyway. So it's not like I'm really missing anything. At that point, you know, all my friends understood what I was doing so I never really got peer pressured because I have, you know, good friends, but I never felt the need to because the prioritization of my health. And it's sad to see that argument being made by, you know, parents of kids that are following this low carb thing where they're like, okay, Mike, I don't think that my kid has a real childhood because he's not, you know, being allowed to eat birthday cakes and cupcakes and all that. That argument doesn't make sense to me because I feel like I've, you know, had an exceptionally amazing childhood, you know, with the friends I eat And birthday parties, like, is the classic example, is like, oh, come eat a birthday cake. Oh, what are you not going to eat a birthday? Like, it doesn't, no one needs that anyway. And I wouldn't, you know, feel peer pressure to just like do that in the first place. So I've never really had an issue with that, but I can sympathize with people who feel like they do.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. Let me ask you, so what do you weigh and what is your like total daily insulin, intake on average?
So right now I weigh probably 180 pounds exactly. Mm-hmm. I'm about 6'2", and insulin, I'll probably take, I would say 30 units of R a day. I'm kind of just saying like three meals, mm-hmm. Probably do 7 to 8 units per meal plus like a snack, which would do like 3 or 4. And then I would say probably 2 to 4 units of the rapid, which I only use for corrections. I never bolus meals with rapid a day. And then as Levemir, I'll probably do 10 or 11 in the morning when I wake up.
Okay. So you're about 50 for the whole day or something like that, somewhere in there.
Yeah, 40, I would say,
something yeah. like that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, there's, and you weigh about 85 kilos. So you're, you know, just about a little over half a unit per kilo or something like that, which is definitely on the lower side. You know, there's studies, it's interesting, there's studies out there looking at diabetics that use insulin, and the ones that use a lot tend to have higher cancer rates than the ones that don't, which is kind of an interesting, I don't know if you've seen that, but there was a study came out a couple of years ago on that. And do you find, I mean, I don't know if you've talked to other people, I just wonder if the requirements are higher if you're more muscular, if you're more active relatively, if you're more sedentary and had less muscle mass. Do you think you require more insulin due to being lean and fit?
I would say that as far as people that are, for an example, someone who's running cross country, I would say that their insulin requirements would probably be less because they're exerting so many, they're losing so many calories, they're losing so much, I guess, sweat throughout the day that probably they would need less insulin to bolus for meals, less Levemir at night, just because of how active they are or the kind of activity they're doing. Maybe for power lifters, it'd be a different story. Someone who weighs 250 is like 6'3 and absolutely like juiced to the gills. I would assume they need more insulin based on just their body mass index and their type of activity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It kind of makes sense to me that would be the case. Cause you know, you still need insulin to put muscle into, protein yeah. into muscle. And so if you're doing that, I'm just wondering if it takes more relatively than just maintaining body fat, I suppose. It'd be interesting yeah. to, maybe Bernstein knows that. Maybe he's looked into that because I haven't seen the information on that. Can you feel when you're going high, when you're going low? Is there any sense of that you can say, hey, I'm getting a little high? Can you kind of predictably predict where you're at? Maybe it's hard. I mean, so some people when they're out of control, they know when they're hypoglycemic, they're, you know, they feel like they're drunk or they're sweating and right. that's a different thing. Right. But can you get an impression that you're going up or down?
I would say that the fact that I basically am never high anyway, I can't really tell, you know, because my high is like a 120 is like a high for me, as opposed to the average type 1 diabetic, which would be like a 250 would be a normal high for them. So I could never feel highs. Lows I can feel if I'm in the 60s, I'll start to, you know, feel a little bit kind of like it's tough to describe. You just feel kind of slightly weaker and then you'll just be like, okay. And you'll check your CGM and be like, oh, okay. I'm like 60. I'm in the 60s and I'll just take a little bit of glucose and then I'm back up in like 5-10 minutes. It's more of a predictive thing for me where I can see my numbers. I have an Apple Watch where I can see it. It makes it easier where, you know, you can kind of predict where the trend of the graph is going. So you can kind of catch that before, you know, you go low before you go high.
And how often do you have these like sort of mini hypos, you know, where you're 60 or something like that?
Probably like once every 2 weeks. It's extremely rare with what I'm doing, and especially being able to, again, like I just said, predict where I'm going. It makes it a lot easier. So hypos and hypers for me are extremely rare. Most of the time, you know, standard deviation below 18 is what I try to keep it, is a good number for me, and I'll be, you know, like 95% between 80 and 110.
Yeah. That's, you know, your blood sugar is better than the average American who is, you know, it's the truth. The average American has right. a hemoglobin A1C, I think of around 5.8. I mean, the average American is pre-diabetic, which is really sad right. to see. And you're a type 1 diabetic, which is the most difficult to control. And you've got far better control on that. Do you know any other type 1 diabetic kids or friends or anything like that? I mean, you probably have some sort of online community or something like that.
Yeah. So I know a lot of the kids that I talk to back home and kind of mentor, I like to, you know, kind of track where they're going, and they'll, you know, sometimes text me with questions. I'm happy to answer. I get DMs from people on Instagram asking, you know, hey, I've been really high these last 2 weeks and don't know really what to do. Would you have it? So I talk to people like that. And being in a bigger environment in college, I see people, you know, that have like the Dexcom that I have, and I'll, you know, they'll see it too. So then we'll have like a little conversation. It's kind of like a reality check, I guess, to see random people that you don't know, because I'm so kind of, I guess, entrenched in this community with people that are also low carb type one. And then to see a random kid that I'll see, you know, at a dining hall with a CGM, and I look at what they're eating, they're drinking like a regular Coke and having like a burrito or something, or like, and like a cookie. And then kind of having that reality check of, okay, you know, that's like 90% of diabetics now. And, you know, I'm doing my best, and everybody else is doing their best in this kind of type one group community to spread the word, but it's still just a very small minority of people.
You know, there's like some, you know, closed loop injection, you know, monitor systems that are out there, kind of artificial pancreas, something like that being talked about in the development. Is that something you'd be ever interested in, or because you've got such good control with this system, you know, because you have something that automatically infuses, you know, an insulin pump in you, is that something you ever looked into or thought about, or is that considered?
Yeah, it's always cool to follow the progress of what they're doing, just from like a scientific standpoint and a mechanical standpoint, just to see, you know, the kind of new things they're coming up with. Like they're another example, they're coming up with a new Dexcom monitor, which is like, I guess, the size of like a quarter, which is something that I would be interested in. But as far as pumps, I've never really been interested in pumps, just from like even an aesthetic point. I don't really like having something just like on my belt that's like a big monitor that, you know, kind of like, I don't want, you know, diabetes to be like my personality. I want to just be, you know, a college student first. As far as pumps go, I don't like it for the aesthetic purpose, as well as it doesn't allow me to have as tight control I have right now with needles, because as far as I know, pumps right now don't allow you to do both kinds of insulins. Like I used, like to use the fast for corrections and then slow for boluses. And I don't think pumps let you do that yet.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah. I think that's a lot of people don't want the pump, the hassle of the pump, and they get clogged up, and you know, then, you know, you don't know if they're working or anything like that. Have you ever had any like issues like bad insulin, or, you know, it expired, or, you know, got old or stuff like that? Has that ever been an issue for you?
So my setup right now is I have a fridge in the back of my room where I keep most of my unopened insulin. And then in my kit, I'll take just an open vial that I have of R, open vial that I have of fast, and just keep that in there. Where I've had trouble sometimes is very early on, you know, if I'm going to the beach with my friends and insulin gets really hot, it can not, you know, work as well. So I've developed, you know, systems for that too. So, you know, in the last, I guess, like 8 years, I haven't had any troubles with like bad insulin or anything like that.
Yeah. Good for you. What are you studying at school, by the way?
I'm a bio major on the pre-med track.
Okay. Right now. Yeah, same thing I did. Yeah. I had my biology degree and went to medical school the same way. So at University of Texas in Austin. So not far from where you are. So good for you, man. Is the interest to eventually go into, say, endocrinology or something like that? Is that where you're thinking you're going to go and deal with type 1 diabetes or something else?
Right now I'm obviously very, you know, passionate about this issue, but I guess I'm not really going to commit myself to anything being in my freshman year, as far as, you know, med school in general, or what I want to do more specifically. I like what I'm doing right now as far as talking to people with diabetes. So that's obviously probably, I guess, the main path that I see myself on right now, but I'm not going to, you know, limit myself to just following that path.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah, you don't know. I mean, it's too hard. You may not like the practice of endocrinology because there's a lot of other stuff you got to deal with. And you know, it's kind of fair enough to see. Fact that the American Diabetes Association, you know, has targets of, you know, hemoglobin A1C, I think under 7. I think American College of Physicians just came out with recommendations between 7 and 8 as a target, which I think is just abysmal. You know, it's just awful to think that.
Right.
And now they're, you know, time in range is, you know, 70% between 70 and 180, which means 30% of the time you could potentially be above 180 or below 170. As a diabetic, living with this since you were a little kid, what are your thoughts on the average sort of how we treat diabetes in general, things like the American Diabetic Association?
I guess my main two emotions would be concern and almost sad, because you see, again, like I mentioned, I see kids at the dining hall with Dexcoms who don't know any better. This is the only thing that they've been told to do. You know, they're having like their Coke and they're having their whatever high carb meal. And that's basically what they've known for the last, you know, however long. And I, you know, out of curiosity, I'll ask kids like, hey, what's your A1C? And that'll always be above 7, which is, again, you know what happens. I'm sure you know the complications that arise even from having an A1C of like 6.5, 6.6, you know, you get increased, you know, risk of you get eyesight problems, you get cardiovascular problems, even like cancer, your susceptibility to cancer increases with high blood sugars and the amount of sugar you eat. So all these complications, which is kind of my fear. Like, I want to be healthy, man. I want to live a normal life. I want to be in my 40s and be looking like how you're looking, you know, being able to lift heavy weight and all that stuff and just be healthy. And with, you know, A1C's above 7, you know, A1C's above 8, you're going to have a lot of other issues in your life that aren't going to allow you to live that healthy life when you're 40, 50.
Yeah, fair enough. And I'm 56. So just for reference. So, but it's important. I mean, it's important to stay active and I think to strength train and obviously eating that. How much protein are you getting in a day? Just out of curiosity, you said about 30 units of R. So I'm assuming about, I don't know. Bernstein talks about, you know, 2 grams or 2 units of insulin or no, a unit of insulin per 2 ounces of protein. I think that's his calculation. Correct me if I'm wrong, but something like that. How much protein are you getting in a day at 85 kilos?
I'm probably doing on a normal day, roughly double my body weight, I think is what I try to shoot for. I'm not really
double your body weight in protein grams, double your pounds or kilograms.
Yeah. I'm not necessarily trying to measure anything that I'm doing right now because I'm not in any sports right now. I'm not in any athletic activities. So I don't necessarily pay close attention to it. I just kind of have developed like this meal plan that I've been on. And that's basically about, I would guess roughly around double my body weight in protein grams per day.
So you're eating over 300 grams of protein a day. Is that what I'm hearing?
Roughly, I would say.
Okay. Well, that's a decent amount. And what does that look like for you? I mean, is it a lot of chicken and eggs and steak or are you eating a lot of plant-based protein?
Yeah. Oh no. Stay away from plant-based protein. Yeah. That's plants completely stay away from plant-based protein. So in the morning, I'll probably do, like, I just got breakfast. It'll be like an omelet at the omelet. They have an omelet bar. So I'll have an omelet and then a few sausages. And then dinner or lunch will be like a double cheeseburger and a salad. I get 2 scoops of tuna and then some cheese and then probably like a piece of chicken or like a double burger.
And this is this at the cafeteria at Baylor?
Yeah, their own cafeteria. Okay. The cafeterias at Baylor are pretty good.
Okay. And then I'm just curious, cause you said you're trying to stay away from the plant-based proteins. Does that differentially affect your blood glucose rise, or you just think it's not an inferior protein source? What's the reason for staying away from
that? I've never even experimented with plant-based proteins. I probably had like one and it tastes like cardboard. So I don't really like it anyway. Okay. And just based on what I know from about plant-based protein, you know, it has like 500 ingredients for like a impossible burger, as opposed to meat, which is just meat, you know? So I try to stay away from that in general. Just because I know how, you know, overly processed and everything, you know, that's in it anyway.
Yeah. I mean, it's fair to say you probably limit how much processed food in your diet in general, right? Is that
right?
Fair to say. And what do you see, you know, cause, and I'm not in, I mean, it's been a long time since I've been in college and hanging out with college kids, but I mean, are you seeing a lot of healthy kids or are you seeing a lot of unhealthy kids running around? I mean, what's the makeup of Baylor University these days?
I would say probably as much as would be, I guess, average. I can't really like quantify, you know, how many kids I look at and I are obviously obese and whatnot, but I think for the most part, pretty healthy. I'm in Texas, so I'm assuming, you know, there's probably more obesity, especially in Texas, as there are in most other states. And, you know, childhood obesity is obviously always on the continual rise anyway. So I do see a lot of what I would consider obese kids here. But not like an alarming rate. I wasn't shocked. Basically, I kind of expected, you know, okay, this is kind of what it's going to be like in college.
Because you came from Hawaii, correct?
Right.
Yeah. So how's the difference from Hawaii to Texas, and how did you pick Baylor? I mean, I'm just kind of curious what prompted you to go to Texas.
I would say really honestly, no difference in opposed to the amount of obesity I see. I would like to see, you know, I think the goal for everybody should be to kind of curb childhood obesity, but it's you know, forever, you know, perpetually rising. So nothing too contrasting from Texas and Hawaii. And as far as Baylor, I didn't really want to go to a Cali school and I didn't want to stay in Hawaii. And I know that Baylor had like a really good pre-med program. I like the size of Baylor. I like that it was a private school. So I just ended up choosing that as I narrow down my choices more and more.
With the cafeteria, you know, I mean, are you on, I'm sure, well, you're on a meal plan where you get X amount of meals per month or something like that.
Yeah.
What is, I mean, how hard is it to eat like you do? Is there plenty of options for you to eat, you know, relatively healthy meals, or is there just, you know, is most of it just junk? I mean, I know when I was like, for instance, the last time I ate in a cafeteria, I was deployed to Afghanistan. We had to eat in a cafeteria every day, and it was just, I mean, there was just miles and miles of junk. I mean, they had food, but I mean, it was a lot of, they had like a grill you could get burgers at, but What is it like for you? Is it mostly junk food in there, or is there some halfway decent stuff?
I would say it's probably like a 50-50 mix. But I've honestly had no problems finding foods for me at each of the, we have, I think, four dining halls, and I think I haven't had any problems with each one of them. You know, there's always burgers. You can always do burgers in a bun. They have a, like fish sometimes, which is nice. They have, they always have chicken, always have a salad bar. So I've really had no issues being able to eat the way I do and sustain that.
So they haven't gone to the, you know, vegan sort of menu or push for that, or eating bugs or any of those things have not fallen in there at Baylor yet. So
yeah,
that's good. At least there's some sanity in Texas, at least.
Oh yeah.
Some places have gone to that, which really kind of is a little bit sad to see.
Yeah. That was a big deciding factor in where I was going to is kind of like what kind of food they would have and serve. So yeah, I wouldn't have gone to a school that's been, you know, going off the deep end with that kind of stuff.
Yeah. Good for you. Good for you for supporting that stuff. Or not supporting that stuff, I suppose. You said early on your dad was able to help you, your parents were able to help you with this. Now, are you completely, I know, cause I think your dad said he's got, you know, he's linked to your CGM at the same time as you are somehow. Mm-hmm. And he still kind of reminds you some stuff like that. Is he still doing much of that?
Yeah. Yeah. It's it'll be, very minimalist. I obviously, you know, I still kind of view this as like a team effort almost, but it's pretty much, I would say 90% me. And then he'll text me every once in a while, like, hey, you're kind of rising. Hey, you're kind of dropping a little bit. And I appreciate those because sometimes, you know, I'm doing tons of stuff, so I'm always kind of busy. So it's kind of nice to have somebody that I know is like backup for me as far as diabetes. Like I never want this to be, I guess, taking up a lot of my mental space with, you know, I have exams, I have classes, I have, you know, social responsibilities I have to take care of too. So another beautiful thing about what I'm doing right now is it allows diabetes to kind of sit on the back burner in my mind. Just because of how easy it is for me now, it's not taking up my mental capacity, you know, with all the other things that I have to be doing.
Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of people where it's, you know, being a type, you know, you think about it, you're literally acting as your own pancreas, which normally just runs in the background, and now you have to make every single decision, and particularly if you're not eating away like you're eating, and you're eating the typical, you know, ADA high carb diet. I mean, you're constantly managing ups and downs all day long. It's got to be exhausting. What, speaking of, you know, because obviously you're still on insulin and somebody has to prescribe it for you. What is your relationship with your new endocrinologist, you know, or whoever you have? Is it somebody from Hawaii now, or you have somebody in Texas, or how do they deal with your great numbers? Or like, what are you doing? So, are they curious?
I've always kept the same endocrinologist because based on like the relationship that we built, he's still obviously a little tentative, but we never disclose that much information, I guess. He sees the results. He sees that, you know, I basically never have hyper or hypoglycemias. And it's like, it's easy for him because he can just go, okay, keep doing what you're doing. And he prescribes this medication. It is, you know, we never really, I guess at this point, look to him for advice. It's kind of just, well, I'll have a, you know, phone call every year at this point. And I'll be like, okay, you know, you still doing what you're doing? Yeah, I'm still doing what I'm doing. I'm taking the same amount of insulin, and then he'll send, you know, prescriptions up, and then I'll be like, okay, how many times are you going low per week? And I'll say, none, basically, which is the truth. And, how many times are you going high? None. And then he goes, okay, you know, see you next year, basically. So there was, I felt a little bit of resistance at first based on just the fact that it was so out of, I guess, his comfort zone to allow someone to do this, because he's obviously always worried about the patients, you know, going low, and then dying. So, he wasn't, I guess, aware of what I was doing, or he didn't understand what I was doing from a nutritional standpoint and, how I was bolusing for them. But once he saw the results of what I was doing, and I guess he saw more and more people kind of follow this method. He said, okay, you know, life is easy for you. Life is easy for me. Just kind of go along and do your thing.
Yeah.
But I have heard, I guess, like horror stories, which I'm sure you have heard of, endocrinologists being completely opposed and restricting their patients from ever trying something like this.
Yeah, it's kind of absurd to think that you've got a patient who's, I would just consider you a model patient for this disease. I mean, you have, you know, the likelihood of you having complications is very, very low, extremely low, mm-hmm. you know, compared to somebody else who's constantly up and down. They may have hypoglycemic episodes. They may have, you know, when they get older, they'll end up with these, all these vascular complications, the retinopathy, the nephropathy, the, you know, cardiovascular complications, on and on and on, the dementia, all the things that are going to go with that.
Right. Yeah. So, even like Alzheimer's and stuff, it increases, which is like I never wanted. Alzheimer's to me is like one of the most terrifying diseases that, you know, someone could have. So mm-hmm. just the fact that chance of Alzheimer's increases with how much sugar you're eating, or I'm sure with hyperglycemia, it's like another reason for me to just continue what I'm doing now.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's fair to say you rarely eat added sugar. You eat, you know, fairly low carb. A lot of people say it's unsustainable. I mean, you've been doing it for now over a decade. What do you say to people say, well, that's just not a sustainable way to live? I mean, what are your thoughts on when people say that?
I think it's easy. I would just say like, it's easy. Like what I'm doing right now is easy. Law of small numbers, which is from the Bernstein book, probably my biggest takeaway. Law of small numbers, again, on the back burner of my mind at this point, very, takes up very little mental space. So it's easy. What I'm doing is easy. I would say far more easy than, you know, going up in the 250s and then having to pull us. Oh my God, I'm 300. I got to do 8 units of, because I ate a cookie and now I'm like 50. And so that in turn makes it way easier is what I'm doing, opposed to what other people that would say that what I'm doing isn't sustainable are doing.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, because some people say, well, I can't give up bread or I can't give up whatever, you know, cookies or mm-hmm. something like that. And you're able to either, I guess, make low carb facsimiles of that or just not need it at all. I mean, how often do you feel like I need a piece of low carb cookie or cake? Is that something you pretty much don't really even feel you need that much?
No, it's nice to have, you know, my mom at that point makes all these almond flour things, which are extremely low carb, easy to bolus for, which, you know, is like a nice little, I wouldn't even say it's a treat because it's not like something that would cause me to rise or anything like that. So yeah, it's nice to have like different low carb alternative. I have, like in my room, I have the Quest protein chips, which, you know, low carb, high protein chips, that I can just like snack on, very easy to bolus for, very easy to manage. So there's alternatives that I eat in my diet. So I'm not eating just like meat and vegetables for every, you know, one of my meals. I have like a dessert, which I don't even like to use the word dessert because it sounds like I'm indulging on something that's high carb. It's really not. It's just like a low carb cookie, which will require like 3 or 4 units of insulin of R and will not rise me at all. I'll still be in the 80s the entire time.
Yeah. Okay. Fair enough. That's good for you to do that. If you were, you know, like in charge of diabetes, you know, maybe one day you will be, who knows, but how would you advise like newly dosed type ones and even type two, how to manage this disease?
Yeah, it would kind of be this overlapping advice that I would give for type one and type two. I don't know as many of the intricacies in type two as I do in type one, but as far as insulin dosing and what I'm doing now, I guess I would just hammer the phrase like law of small numbers, kind of show them, I guess, what other people are doing similar to me, what I'm doing. And I guess show them the increased risk of complications when you're following what would be like the standard ADA diet and what those blood sugars look like as opposed to what my blood sugars look like and what other people that are doing the Bernstein method and what their blood sugars look like and kind of compare and contrast those. I think it's very important to talk to the parents as well, especially if it's a kid under 10 that's getting diagnosed with diabetes, because I guess if your parents aren't doing what you're doing, then it makes it incredibly hard. Like if your parents tell you, okay, you know, we're going to not eat cookies anymore, we're not going to do oatmeal anymore, but we're still going to do that in front of you, it makes it extremely hard for the kid to follow just from a psychological standpoint what they're doing. So I guess parents, I'd say most important thing for them is to be supportive and be all in with what their kid is doing, which is what I was fortunate enough to have. And then just show the kids the results, show the kids, you know, it's very easy to do. And I guess depending on the age of the kid, you would kind of dumb it down or make it more complicated. As if they were 8, as opposed to like 19, like I am.
Yeah. And you've got, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you've got a younger brother. And so he probably, did he shift his diet like the same time as you did?
Right.
Did he start eating in a lower carb way too? And he's okay with that. He doesn't like feel like, oh, I'm getting ripped off because you're a diabetic or anything like that.
No, not at all.
Okay.
Yeah. Not at all. Again, like what he would be, what people would say he would be missing, we can just make almond flour versions of that, which, you know, low carb and taste basically the same. So he's And he's also, like I mentioned earlier, he just came down to play water polo. Like, he looks awesome. He's doing whatever he wants, athletically, mentally. So he's thriving in life too. So again, it's not really like important for him to, you know, have like a cupcake, you know, a gluten cupcake or something like that.
Got it. I think it was you, maybe it was your brother. There was a presentation looking at the curves. You know, there was like an online thing that was, maybe it was you that did that. Was that you or your brother?
I think that might've been, I know my brother is doing something with curves and insulin, but I've also kind of talked about that thing in the past too. So it could have been either one of us.
Okay.
I think it was my brother. More recently, it was probably my brother.
Okay. Yeah. I remember your dad talking about that at one point. But so, I mean, do you have a social media like presence or anything like that? Do you talk about diabetes on social media?
I don't, my personal social medias, but people have, as an extension, reached out to me on my Instagram, for example, and asked me questions. But my main, I guess, thing would be that type 1 grit, which I kind of managed with my dad. And obviously I know a lot of the people in it and they kind of know me as a person based on, you know, I get advertised a lot there on what I'm doing. So then they can like, feel free to ever reach out to me. If anybody's listening to this with questions and stuff, I love fielding questions from people and having discussions about what I'm doing or kind of ways to work this out. So I love getting questions from people. So yeah.
So that's Type 1 Grit on Facebook, correct?
Type 1 Grit on Facebook, as well as on my personal Instagram. People can feel free to ask me questions anytime they want there.
And what is your personal Instagram?
I think it's David underscore Dikeman. It's pretty easy.
Okay. David underscore Dikeman, D-I-K-E-M-A-N, correct? So awesome. Well, I unfortunately have to go. David, thank you so much. This has been wonderful. Thank you so much for having me. You're inspirational as far as, you know, what you're doing, and good luck with the biology degree in medical school. And I hope you go on to help to transform the diabetes world, because we need it for sure. And thanks for doing what you're doing. All right, guys. Yeah. See you guys tomorrow. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye, David. Take care.
Thank you.